our chief guest, Professor P.C. Joshi, Acting Vice Chancellor of University of Delhi, our guest of honor, Mr. K.V. Rao, President of Singapore Indian Fine Arts Society, Singapore, and the keynote speaker is going to be Mr. Dinesh K. Patnaik, Director General of Indian Council for Cultural Relations. Let's begin with a Saraswati Vandana propitiating the goddess of knowledge, wisdom, and music, Saraswati ji. Sargam Choir is presenting this Saraswati Vandana, directed by Dr. Prasanth G. Pai, sung by students of our music faculty, V. Ananya, S. Bhargavi, P. R. Radhika, Vandana Rohila, Shreshtha Hariharan. Violin by Raghavendra Prasad, Mridangam by V. M. Kanan, Tanpura by Satakshi Mishra. Composed by Chandrasekhar Bharati, the music of this piece is composed by Sri R.K. Sri Ram Kumar. Saraswati Vandana in Rag Hamir Kalyani, set to Mishra Chapu Talam. I request Professor Deepti Omchery Bhalla, Dean, Faculty of Music and Fine Arts, University of Delhi, to present her welcome address.
Namaskar. It is my privilege and pleasure to welcome all dignitaries, eminent scholars and musicians who are participating in the two-day international webinar on the theme, The Traditional Music in Different Cultures, Challenges and Opportunities in the Changing Global Scenario. I'm grateful to our chief guest, Professor P.C. Joshi, Vice Chancellor, Delhi University, for his presence and his inaugural address. I welcome Mr. K.V. Rao, President, Singapore Indian Fine Arts Society, with whom we just signed an MOU. I welcome Mr. Dinesh K. Patnaik, DG ICCR, who has kindly agreed to give the keynote address. I also have the pleasure of welcoming all the scholar speakers. Dr. Paolo Pacciola from Italy, Dr. Ravi Bandhu Vidyapati from Sri Lanka, Dr. Vararat Varirak from Thailand, Dr. Mariam Gharsu from Iran, Dr. Stan Scott and Professor Dorothy Hast from USA, Ms. Va Bofari from Cambodia, Professor Manop Vishutipat from Thailand, and the two eminent concert musicians, Dr. S. V. Sahana from Mysore and renowned Hindustani vocalist Padmashri Pandit Madhu Mudgal. Culture is an identity of any civilization, and music plays a very dominant role in culture of any region. The rich variety of folk music, as also the tribal music, command the same importance and respect as does its language, dialect, dress, and social customs. Music has always played an important role in the development of any society, and therefore its significance in the social fabric of a country stands unrefuted. The ethnomusic of any region, with its astounding varieties, makes the study of music across nations very unique and absorbing. The globalization of music has had its impact on the traditional music of every country, which has had to struggle hard so as to protect and sustain its own distinct identity. What has been worse this year is the advent of coronavirus, which has afflicted human life and human interactions and drastically impacted the economy of every country. Art and artists have been worst hit, with all performances coming to a complete halt, leaving many struggling to keep the both ends meet. Yet, undeterred by the COVID-19 pandemic, the Department of Music, Faculty of Music and Fine Arts, Delhi University, has moved forward with organizing academic and cultural events for the benefit of its student. With the support of Delhi University and the world-renowned scholars and musicians, we now proudly present a two-day international webinar. As the title suggests, the aim of the webinar is to bring to focus the aesthetic beauty and innate quality inherent in the music of different countries, while addressing the challenges they face in retaining the same. I'm sure this will be a fruitful event with fascinating music that will enthrall all. We are also proud to release the 35th volume of the department's prestigious research journal, Vageshwari. This is a special issue dedicated to the late scholar and art historian, Padma Vibhushan Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan, whom we lost recently. The journal has two sections. The first section includes homage to the late scholar by eminent personalities from different fields who were very closely associated with her. The second section includes the proceedings of the national seminar held in October 2019. I wish to commend the dedicated efforts of my editorial board, especially the young team of assistant editors who worked tirelessly in the transcription work of the addresses of many speakers who participated in the 2019 seminar. I pray that the scourge of coronavirus afflicted the lives of people is defeated soon, and that we may resume our normal lives the world over, including the much awaited conduct of concerts and music education in the offline mode. Let us have the positive blessings of Udara Charita Namstu Vasudeva Kutumbakam, one world, one family of benevolent and generous people. I welcome all once again. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you, Deepti ji. Professor P.C. Joshi is our chief guest of the day. He's the acting vice chancellor of Delhi University. Professor P.C. Joshi has been the head of Department of Anthropology in the University of Delhi. He served as head of the department in various institutions like H&B Garhwal University and Institute of Human Behavior and Allied Sciences. He is the recipient of the Indira Priyadarshini Vrikshamitra National Award, besides numerous other awards which have been bestowed upon him. Besides 9 books, his papers numbering more than 150 have appeared in several national and international journals. Sir has supervised many PhD and MPhil students. Professor P.C. Joshi to kindly deliver his inaugural address.
Good morning to dignitaries who have come to grace this webinar on a very important theme, traditional music in different cultures, opportunities and challenges in the changing global scenario. I would like to, at the outset, congratulate the Faculty of Music and Fine Art and its dynamic leader, Professor Deepti Bhalla Omchery, and her dynamic team members, faculty members, for initiating such an important discussion on a topic of vital importance. Music is an integral part of human life, and I think since the human beings learned the art of speaking, music was there. Human beings as primates are great learners by virtue of being cultural animals and social animals, but at the same time, they also imitate. And I think if you look into the very simple hunting-gathering societies, we know that in the art of hunting, they quite frequently use imitations of animal sounds. In fact, there is some school of thought which says that shamanism evolved, which of course is a kind of esoteric musical tradition, evolved when human beings wanted to go for hunting and wanted to assure success in hunting, because hunting was a very, very uncertain and unpredictable activity, and human beings always wanted to be successful because that was, meat was a very important source in the initial days. I think music started in group form first, going to individual rendition of music by the great artists whose photographs I can see on this great hall, right from Pandit Ravi Shankar to Ustad Amir Khan Sahib, and so on and so forth. But I think the beginning of music was, perhaps it was a binding force initially. It was what made human beings social animals. If you go to Nagaland, you can see that collective sounds that people make, a very unique music that comes, especially war music, where they create certain sounds together and the rhythms keep on forming. So it is like people start creating sounds and then the rhythms start moving. And I think classical music is a very, very extreme form of improvement upon those collective singings. Well, I'm not an expert in music. I'm only a person who is connoisseur of music. I myself am a bad singer, but I like music. I like listening to music like others also, of people like me. And when we're talking of traditional music, we are basically talking of the early music. We are basically talking of the eternal music. We are basically talking of the folk music. We are talking of the music which is maybe rendered in a group form, in the earlier forms, which starts from maybe hunting-gathering societies to pastoral societies, where art of animal raising was accompanied by music. You have in great God, Lord Krishna, the flute player or flute. And if you go and see the pastoralist, the Gadariya so-called, they play very nice music. And it is very important for them to play that music, not because they want to be great singers, but because they want to attract the flock of animals and they want to guide this flock of animals, because these animals needed to be guidance, and this guidance comes from music. So I think ultimately music is an integral part of human life. We are human beings, we speak, and therefore we create music, we listen to music, and we propagate music. And traditional music is a base. In the era of globalization, like rightly the topic is, there is a challenge to this music. There is a challenge, people are migrating from one place to other place. So music which was giving rhythm to their agriculture, the agricultural cycle is broken, the animal raising cycle is broken now because of globalizations. So what is happening to that music? What is happening to that traditional music? What is happening to that eternal music? I think time has come to preserve most of it, because we might lose it over a period of time, because with culture, losing of culture, with losing of language, we may also lose this music. So therefore, it is very, very important that we preserve, we document it. There is a new subject, I think ethnomusicology. Ethnomusicology is all about preserving and conserving the music, because that is the root, that is the root of all the music that we see in the world today. So I would like to congratulate Madam Professor Deepti Omchery Bhalla, and also the faculty members and research scholars and students of this department, this great department, for thinking about these state-of-the-art topics and also showing concern for preservation and conservation of these music forms. So with these words, I again would like that this particular webinar comes out with very good recommendations, which of course should then be sent to the relevant policymakers for preservation and conservation of traditional music. Thank you very much.
I'm very glad that it's a UCC here.
Yes.
and go for more, I think, more rigorous peer review process in this, so that it gets more, you know, becomes more standardized.
I'm
glad that you are releasing it in honor of great lady.
Yes, she has been associated. She has been part of alumni, actually.
She has been an
alumni. Miranda, yes, she was from Miranda.
Miranda.
We thank our chief guest, Professor P.C. Joshi, for his inaugural address. Mr. K.V. Rao is the president of Singapore Indian Fine Arts Society, Singapore, and he is our guest of honor of this day. He has worked in diversified industries and enterprises in leadership positions. Sir specializes in international business and has an experience that covers 40 countries in the developed and emerging markets with a focus on Asia. He is currently the resident director of ASEAN for Tata Sons Private Limited, promoter of the Tata Group based in Singapore. He is the recipient of Distinguished Alumnus of the Year 2011 award from his alma mater, the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, New Delhi, India. He's a blogger, speaker, and has a keen interest in Indian classical music. Mr. K.V. Rao to deliver his address.
Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are. Director General of the Indian Council of Cultural Relations, His Excellency Mr. Dinesh Patnaik, Acting Vice Chancellor of Delhi University, Professor Joshi, Dean of the School of Music, Professor Deepti, Omchery, Bhalla, dignitaries, musical friends from the world over, and we're all talking today the language of music, which is all about oneness. I'm very impressed with the theme of this international webinar on traditional music during these difficult and changing times. I'd like to step back and start with a bit of history. Music and art are truly an embodiment of our culture, and they do provide us the identity of what we are. Coming from Singapore, a tiny island country in Asia, the history of this region and that of India is so well intertwined for over hundreds of years, and Indian music, culture, art, religion, Buddhism, Hinduism, and all of that have permeated into the whole of Southeast Asia and Far East and have given a different color and dimension to Indianness, which gives you a familiarity when you come to Southeast Asia. In the more modern times, in the 19th century onwards, both Singapore and India were colonies of the British Empire, and Indians started migrating to Singapore in the early 1819. 2019 marked 200 years of the early arrival of Tamils into Singapore. It's an interesting history, which we have also shared on the independence side, where Subhash Chandra Bose came to Singapore and declared India an independent country, and the Azad Hind Fauj was active out of Singapore too. Way back when Swami Vivekananda was on his journey to Chicago, he stopped over in Singapore, and in 1928, the Ramakrishna Mission was formed here. Well, let's move on to a little more closer to the 1945s, when the Second World War was just coming to an end and Singapore was under Japanese occupation, and the Japanese just about exited at that time on 15th of August 1945. 2 years later, 15th of August 1947, India got its independence. And 1949, 2 years later, the early leaders of the Indian community in Singapore, 10 visionary gentlemen, cast the seed to set up Singapore Indian Fine Arts Society, to promote, to train, and to develop, and to cultivate the culture of traditional Indian music, which included Karnatak, vocal, instrumental, dance, Bharatanatyam, and later years, Hindustani got added to it. Today, as we are in 2021, 72 years of our history has brought us to a stage where we are one of the foremost institutions around the world training and performing in Indian classical music, dance, and arts. We have 15 faculties, 2,050 students, 40 staff, and 28 gurus working full-time in Singapore. And it's an active and very vibrant center of Indian classical music and dance. As we all transcend together the COVID times, I would like to share a few thoughts about our role as promoters of music and art. These are times when people are actually rediscovering themselves, locked out from the world, as it were, and trying to go within and reinvent themselves. These are times when people are coming back to their passions and their hidden arts and potential, and music gives us a lot of peace and a lot of purpose and a new meaning to our lives. Today, the world's number one challenge and problem is mental health. And there is nothing better than the pursuit of music that gives you a calm, that gives you a silence, it gives you a meditative poise and a mindfulness that nothing else can give you as much as Indian classical music can. In fact, Mahatma Gandhi had said, "Music has given me peace. I can remember occasions when music instantly tranquilized my mind when I was generally agitated over something. Music has helped me to overcome my anger." These are Mahatma Gandhi's words, which in effect says it makes you a better human being. These are times for collaboration, facilitated through digitalization. And today we could be talking to each other no matter where, in which part of the world we are. We can share our music, we can learn, we can develop music, we can produce music and art together, and the world has become indeed a small place with digitalization. Interestingly enough, music is also a paradox of kinds. It has no language, race, or division, yet it has an identity of its own, it has a syntax of its own, it has structure and it can depart from structure. It can be something very independent. It can be blended. It can be. It has a shape and form, and it also becomes formless in its purest rendition. It is indeed truly unity in diversity that brings really the world together. And if we can talk through music, I think we'll be a happier world. In fact, Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore said, "Music fills the infinite that exists between two souls." In these difficult times, we also have a challenge in dealing with the new generation. How do we preserve our culture? How do we preserve our classical arts? Because traditional music and arts taught in a traditional manner does not seem to make enough sense to the young generation, and it might become a disservice to pursue tradition in a traditional way. Perhaps it's time for us to render traditional music and teach it in a non-traditional manner. These are times to embrace technology. These are the times to be flexible and allow creative liberties to flourish. These are the times to encourage adventure and experimentation. Perhaps our theme should be classical yet trendy, classical yet contemporary, classical yet snazzy and cool, for making it relevant and attractive to the new generation. Today is a very special moment for Singapore Indian Fine Arts Society, as we concluded a comprehensive memorandum of understanding with Delhi University to collaborate across cultural, academic, and research areas in the broad field of music and arts. This gives us a new impetus to collaborate on multiple areas, and the scope is wide-ranging, from attracting regional talent, developing talent, improving the quality of teaching, courseware, syllabus, methods of teaching, as also mutual recognitions in certain areas. And it also provides the stage for us to do some programs together and put up some shows which can be taken around the world and particular Southeast Asia. We also would like to use this opportunity to provide a platform for our senior students beyond their years at SIFAS to pursue professionally music and art, and they could be moving to or taking help from Delhi University to achieve their career goals. This is a very broad area for collaboration, and we look forward to embarking on this new journey to make art and music even more vibrant in our part of the world. On this occasion, my deepest thanks to Professor Deepti, Omchery, Bhalla, and Aranya and team in Delhi University Department of Music, who have worked with us for the last several months to bring to this happy conclusion. I'd also like to thank my colleague Puneet Pushkarni in the committee and Menaka Gopalan, our acting principal, who have worked with Delhi University to conclude this beautiful memorandum of understanding. This new pathway is going to bring a lot of color, a lot of vibrancy, and a lot of activity for both our institutions that we look forward in the new world order. I'd like to thank each and every one of you and all my members in SIFAS for this occasion. And I'd like to thank everyone listening in for your time and attention. Thank you.
We would thank Mr. K.V. Rao for his address, and now his students, that is the students from SIFAS, are presenting a musical program.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for that beautiful rendition. Our keynote speaker of the day is Shri Dinesh K. Patnaik, Director General, Indian Council for Cultural Relations. He's a career diplomat of the Indian Foreign Service with experience of over 25 years in a variety of interesting and challenging assignments. He has served in Indian missions in Geneva, Dhaka, Beijing, and Vienna. At headquarters, he has served in the Europe West, External Publicity, Africa, and UN divisions. He was India's ambassador to Cambodia and Morocco and Deputy High Commissioner of India in London. Keynote address by Shri Dinesh K. Patnaik.
Namaskar. I'm delighted that the Department of Music, University of Delhi, is organizing an international webinar on the subject of traditional music in different cultures, challenges and opportunities in the changing global scenario. This is a great topic. It focuses on music. Music is perhaps the most universal of all the performing arts and is found in every society. It is an integral part of our intangible cultural heritage, including rituals, festive events, oral traditions. It can be found in the most diverse of contexts. Can be sacred, it can be profane, classical or popular music. It can be closely associated with work and even with entertainment. There are many parts to music. There's a political dimension to it, there's an economic dimension to it. Music recounts a community's history. It sings the praises of powerful leaders, powerful people. It plays a key role in economic transactions, and music is played in many occasions. And what all? It can be in marriages, it can be in funerals, religious rituals, festivities, entertainment, social functions, and even for personal happiness. So music is something which has been through history from the beginning of society. Whether any ancient civilization that one looks at, whether it's the Indus Valley civilization, Greek civilization, Roman, Egyptian, Mesopotamian, Indian, Chinese, music has always played an important role. Because music gives a nation its identity, its cultural identity. whatever be the kind of music, flamenco or the Celtic music of Spain, roots music in US, or the Gagaku court music of Japan, all of these music gives an identity to the nation that it comes from. And this is important because the cultural diversity and the variety of music found in different places, which makes the study of music very interesting. Similarly, Indian music is one of the oldest musical traditions in the world. If you look at the Indus Valley civilization, we had sculptures which showed dance and musical instruments, like the seven-hold flute. But instruments, many stringed instruments and drums were discovered from Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. Even in our Vedas, the Rig Veda has elements of present Indian music. It has even a musical notation which denotes the meter and the mode of chanting. So these are the things which are there. India's classical musical tradition is a millennia long and remains important to the lives of Indians today also as a source of religious inspiration, cultural expression and mostly entertainment. But this kind of traditional music across the world faces challenges, various challenges. There are various ways in which this musical diversity is threatened. Local musical traditions actually come out from the local life, from the rural life, from the traditional life of people. And when the circumstances of the rural life changes, when rural people move or the rural milieu changes, then these kind of musics get lost. There are also many governments which, when they have multiple ethnicities, try to assimilate them into a single cultural identity. This creates a problem where many of the musical traditions get lost. There are some countries like in Afghanistan, like in other places, in Mali, where religious fundamentalism is trying to silence music completely. So these are the issues which music faces. But the biggest threat that the music faces comes from the homogenizing effect of Western music. This is both a commercial as well as classical music. Everything gets affected by the homogenizing effect of Western music. If you look at the beginning of the last century, musicians across the world were told by the leaders, by people, that the indigenous monophonic styles that they had were very backward, and that in order to compete on the international stage, they need to deploy Western polyphony. Now, Indian music is one of the few which survived this attack, because what happens is Indian classical music, like all of us know, is monophonic. It's based on a single melody or a line called raga, rhythmically organized through talas. But Indian music survived. But the world over, this is what traditional music is facing. And what has globalization done? Globalization has brought with it the power of a very strong, homogeneous, Western-sponsored pop music and what we call it modern music, which is backed by enormous marketing budgets. This kind of music, which is very monotonic in its way, but polyphonic in its effect, is displacing local musical traditions. But here we come to another point. Do we need to maintain the purity of music? Because music has always evolved. It has changed over. I know traditional music, which is getting lost, needs to be protected and conserved. But music cannot just survive on artificial support. Without a driving social impulse, without the participation of people, music cannot survive. It just becomes a piece of museum culture. And many of the fate of the music across the world is happening like that. They're becoming pieces to just be conserved. And we should do it. I mean, I'm not saying we should not do it, but this is an important part of our history that we need to keep. Because do we believe that if classical musics go, new musical form will fill in? If the old traditional music go, will new music fall? Earlier it used to happen, when traditional music moves, there are new forms which used to come in. But today, given the exponential rate at which the world is growing, given the homogenizing effect of Western music, and given the way the geopolitical order is mutating, it is hard to imagine that new traditional forms will come. So it's important that we protect and save the old traditional forms that we're used to. I'm very happy because today, at least in the world, among music circles and among people who are looking at it, the world has changed. Today, that linear model of the classical evolution of classical music, that is in Western theory, is changed. They're looking at a more wider model in which music has popped up from across the world. There is no linear model of classical music. And so this is the thing. But what has happened recently? Despite all this, now with COVID-19, we face a major challenge. Music world has been impacted disastrously. There is not only just the health impact of the virus on the people practicing music, but it's also had a lot of impact on performances, on people going out, meeting people. People are now performing online, which without the effect of having close-to-close people-to-people interaction actually has a bad effect on music. These kind of things has created a devastating effect on music. But music this time also has evolved. People have realized that music is the soul of any culture. And so new forms have devised. There is a new resurgence which is happening. In fact, in all difficult times, in times of pandemic, in times of world disasters, music has been the solace which has actually allowed humanity to survive. So I'm delighted that this webinar is being held. This webinar, the experts will discuss different traditional music across the world in different countries, what has happened in the last few years, 100 years. It will also study the challenges and opportunities that are there for traditional music. The discussion is going to be amazing. I'm looking forward to listening to the discussion. And it's also going to see how COVID-19, which has had a tremendous impact on the world, has changed the way music was done and how it is going to evolve in the future. All these things which has been done is going to be very important for the future of our world. Delhi University is doing it. It's important because it also has an effect on how music is going to be taught in the future. So I wish the organizers of this conference the very best. It's a wonderful initiative. We need more such initiatives in India, and I wish you all the best. Have a great seminar. Thank you very much and Namaskar.
After the inaugural session, we now move to our first session of the webinar, Ethnic Music in Eastern Europe, Italy. Chairing this session is Professor Anupam Mahajan, and our panel consists of Dr. Paolo Paciola from Italy. Professor Anupam Mahajan is a senior most professor and former head and dean of this department. She is a graduate in psychology and holds master's, MPhil and doctorate in music from this department. Apart from being a performer in All India Radio and Doordarshan with a top grade, she is an empaneled artist of ICCR and Ministry of Human Resource Development. Professor Anupam Mahajan has presented and published various articles, research papers, books, and has been a visiting professor in various universities. She has performed extensively across India and in many foreign countries, including Mauritius, Singapore, London, Paris, Switzerland, Thailand, and so on, to promote and propagate Indian classical music. Professor Anupam Mahajan. Our panelist of this session is Dr. Paola Paciola, ethnomusicologist and an eminent musician from Italy. He's presently Tagore National Fellow affiliated with Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts. Also ICCR Senior Fellow affiliated with International Center for Kerala Studies. He taught ethnomusicology at the Conservatory of Music A. Pedrolo of Vicenza and Middle East and Indian drums at the Conservatory of Music Tito Skipa of Lecce. He's the author of the monographs The Indian Drum of the King God and the Pakhavaj of Nathdwara. His research interests include a number of interrelated areas within ethnomusicology, organology, iconography of music, history and archaeology of music, and musical instruments and religious studies. He's particularly interested in the ritual functions of music, musical instruments and dance, and in the relationship of music and images, intended as painted or enacted representations in India. His main ethnographic focus is on music in India, where he has carried out extensive field research on the language and ritual functions of drums and drumming. I now request Professor Anupam Mahajan to begin the session.
Namaskar. Welcome you all to this 2-day international seminar on traditional music in different cultures, opportunities and challenges in a changing global scenario. I would first like to talk about changing global scenario. You all must have felt the impact of pandemic time past 1 year. It has impacted us mentally, socially, technology-wise, and economic-wise. So this is for the first time that we are going for online seminar in Delhi University Music Department. But this has been made possible to you from learning from the challenges that we have come across during the pandemic time. Our team, who is going to make it possible for you, is not a technical team, but who has become technical by learning these challenges, as we had to use a lot of e-sources platforms. So today this is being made possible to you under the technical team of Dr. Ajay Kumar and under the academic team of Professor Ananya Kumar Day. So I am really grateful to both of them for making it possible for me to reach out to all of you throughout the world to share this first session with all of you. Now I would like to talk about tradition. What is tradition? Tradition is actually transmitting your values, your customs, your ideas, your day-to-day interaction within your families, within the society. And this is not done through any kind of formal training. Rather, it is done through day-to-day living and interaction with your family and with the society as such. And that is transmitted to the next generation. For any society to live, it is very important for their culture to have these values and traditions so that they can survive in the world. And this kind of a survival is possible only when these kind of values are transmitted to the next generation. And tradition always have two types. Number one, classical traditions. Number two, folk traditions, whom we now call as ethnic traditions when they have been now combined with anthropology. And one such tradition is being brought to you by Professor Paolo Pacciola, whom I now request to please come onto the stage and share his paper. His paper he's going to present on traditional music of Salento, societies, identities, and politics. So he's covering all the aspects of any tradition. So I welcome Professor Pacciola to be on the dais to present his paper. Thank you.
Hello, hi everybody. I'm very glad to share my paper in this interesting meeting. And I would like to start thanking Professor Omchery Bhalla for having invited me to this and the entire department of music. I thank also everybody who will be listening to the lecture. I'm start immediately sharing. Italy is a thin and elongated strip of land which protrudes into the middle of the Mediterranean Sea. Connected to the continental body of Europe by Alps, it almost reaches the northern coast of Africa. The culture of Italy is as multifaceted, as variegated as its nature. Traditional music reflects such a picture in terms of variety of musical forms and musical instruments. The geographical area on which this lecture focuses is the extreme tip of the eastern side of the peninsula, which I'm going to show this area here in this enlarged It is the district of Lecce, usually called Salento, which is placed in the southern part of the region Puglia. I will first introduce the folk tradition, the music and musical instrument of this area as they appeared in the decades following the post-Second World War, and then I will trace some aspects of its recent evolution in order to point out how historical and social changes have contributed to the process. Salento is a dry rocky land, almost devoid of rivers, that during summers is scorched by the sun. The landscape is characterized by a vast plantation of olive trees and grapes and punctuated by a number of municipalities. Until the 1960s, the life and economy of these municipalities mostly revolved around agriculture. And the lives of the peasants was regulated by the agricultural calendar and the religious celebrations. Music making was connected with specific moments of the religious and agricultural year, such as Christmas, Easter, marriages, harvest, and accompanied the work in the field. I just start launching a short audio. This is a folk song, work song. This was just to give an idea, starting giving an idea of the acoustic of this and the typical sound of the tradition. Music was rarely played as an entertainment and to accompany dances. It was a necessary or completing element of a specific celebration or life situation. Musicians were not professionals, although some families were more inclined to music and transmitted the songs from one generation to another. The main musical instruments were the frame drum tamburello and organetto, the high tonic accordion. Minor instruments were friction drum opacupa, mandolin and violin. While organetto was introduced at the end of the 19th century replacing the bagpipe, tamburello was ancient and particularly connected with agriculture. It was made as it were a sieve, but a goatskin was fixed on the circular wooden frame instead of the grid. In fact, this drum was emblematic of the agricultural world. Music was essential in a rather unique ritual performed to ill people who had been bitten by the taranta. It was a spider diffused in this district, whose bite was thought to cause periodical depression, distress, and altered states of consciousness. Those who had been bitten were called tarantati, and the phenomenon had been called tarantism. Music was one of the most important elements of the healing ritual. It was said that the bite of the spider was associated with specific melodies and rhythms, and that by listening to such melodies and rhythms during the healing ritual, the tarantata would have been, at least temporarily, released from the afflictions caused by it. The ritual, which might last from several hours to days, was held in the house of the tarantata. A cloth was laid down on the floor, and the person who had to be cured was placed over it. The musicians were mostly people of the same community of the tarantata, used to play standing or sitting near to the ritual's place created by the cloth. Since they had to discover music connected with the spider who had bitten the woman and or man under treatment, they used to start playing different melodies and rhythms in order to identify the right one, and in doing so at times they played placing the instrument very near to the ears of the Taranta. Once the right music was found, the tarantata would have started dancing a sequence of movements, including the stomping of the feet on the floor, a step which resembled pressing of the spider under the feet. I'm going to show you now a short clip from a documentary that was shot by Ernesto De Martino, the famous anthropologist who conducted fieldwork research in 1959, recording it. I'll just go to a point in. This is the recorded during, this was recorded during the healing ritual. The tarantata is behind the curtain. And comes out of the door. And this is the cloth, the white cloth, where she's going to sit. Her movements. And this is Tamburello, the old one. La tarantata si fa ragno, diventa il ragno che è in lei. Il suo pensiero si muove in ritmo puro e nel movimento quasi meccanico sorgono figure di liberazione, travolte però ancora da ombre disperate. From this, the ritual includes different stages. And at a certain point, she will start dancing. But I have to stop here. The ritual had been appropriated by the Catholic Church, and the power to heal from the venom of the spider attributed to Saint Paul, who, you can see here where she dances, who had been bitten by a dangerous snake remaining unharmed. Thus the efficacy of the music healing ritual had to be sanctioned by the saint, his grace. The 29th of June, the day of the year devoted to the Saint Paul, was considered very powerful, and Tarantati used to gather to his chapel in the municipality of Galatina to ask for his grace. Women and men, accompanied by their relatives, flocked to the shrine to convey their uneasiness and distress to the saint. Someone crawling, someone else climbing on the altar of the saints. Here. Others shouting. This was a public ritual. Indeed, the visit of the Tarantata to the chapel used to be attended by a number of persons who were curious to see what the numerous Tarantata were able to perform under the effects of the bite of the spider. Here it is inside the chapel. However, excluding the day of the visit to the chapel, where it was necessary to exhibit the illness, the presence of tarantata in a family was not only a huge problem to manage, but also shame, a kind of negative mark, for these people trying to keep it secret. The industrial expansion and significant growth of the national economy that followed the end of the Second World War were mostly a North Italy phenomenon. In fact, the so-called Italian economic miracle reached South Italy only during the 1960s. Along with American culture, which was propagated by the media, it brought significant cultural and social changes, the most significant being the emergence of a middle class. Interestingly, it looked at the agricultural world with its hardship and poverty as a world belonging to the past, as something to be forgotten and even denied. Folk music and musical instruments were deeply associated with that world in rituals and festivals. That's why they followed the same destiny. Being emblems of hard life, they survived only among few communities in peripheral and less developed areas of the country. During the 1970s, many leftist groups distributed all over Italy started a process of folk revival with the aim to give back the peasants and the workers their own culture. It was a deliberate and political direct action. They intended to recover the forgotten culture of a class and to give it to the same dignity of the elite culture. The writer and activist Rina Durante was the leading figure of the folk revival in Salento and strongly contributed to the birth of the Canzoniere Grecanico Salentino, the first folk revival group of Salento. The repertoire included a number of songs collected on the field and original pieces composed by the members of the groups. This first revival did not last long and remained mostly restricted to specific events organized by the left party, and by the end of the 1970s had become completely vanished. In fact, the social situation was such that the concerts were not even welcomed by the farmers, who were more interested to listen to the light music broadcasted on radio and television than to recall the hardship lived by their parents. However, the Canzoniere Grecanico Salentino laid down the basis for the second wave of folk revival that would have come a few years later. The 1980s were marked by an impressive technological development. They were the climax of the process of economic growth evolved in the previous decades and represented the full establishment of the capitalistic economy and the birth of new methods of work organization. The fall of the Berlin Wall, which sanctioned the end of the then dominating political ideologies, the growth of industrialization and the beginning of globalization created the space for new ideas and the need that became manifest during the 1990s. In fact, at the beginning of the 1990s, the situation was changed. And Salento became, all of a sudden, land of access of transit to Europe of a dramatic flux of immigration arriving from Albania and the Middle East. Here this picture was historical because of the importance of the flux that literally invaded Salento. Globalization activated the process of rediscovery of local identities and renewed interest for folk tradition. The search for the tradition and roots was thought as a remedy to uncertainty and confusion deriving from global movements of goods and knowledge. All these issues were discussed at the general level, but were particularly significant for young people and university students, who were also engaged in uprising against the privatization of universities. Folk music was embraced by youth movement along with other emerging musical genres such as hip-hop, reggae and ragamuffin as a means to strengthen group cohesion and as emblem of a better world. It was used to strengthen the local identity in a world without borders and to create collective identity against the individualism dominating the society. The second wave of folk revival looked at the near past of the agricultural world of farmers and peasants in a romanticized way and laid emphasis on the aesthetic of music rather than on to texts. While the first wave did not make fortune, the second wave spread like a virus within a few years. Although the beginning this music was mostly played in private gatherings, it soon moved to concert stages. Some of the protagonists of the folk revival of the 1970s were the first to found new groups. The few living representatives of the tradition, and they were followed by many other groups that were created just on their strength. The few living representatives of the folk tradition, being the ones who had carried on and safeguarded the tradition, gained huge respect and became popular like pop stars. The part of the repertoire which was soon mostly appreciated was the so-called pizzica tarantata, or simply pizzica, that one that we just heard in the documentary, the music which guided the healing ritual. It was based on a powerful and exciting rhythm which induced to dance. Maestro Stefani, who was also in the video, the last music healer and good violinist, became an idol on Nandi's pizzica, a model to be copied. Tamburel was elected as the symbol of the tradition. Being the rhythmic pattern of the pizzica fascinating, people started learning how to play the drum. This music soon became viral, attracting more and more people. Dance steps were created to dance the pizzica. The folk revival soon became a huge movement of people gathering to dance and beat the pizzica rhythm together. The needs of drums increased so much that tamburello making becomes a business. Within a few years, pizzica started to be seen as the music of a collective dance ritual. It was ideologized and as a contemporary version of the healing ritual, which was no longer emblem of distress and cause of shame, but symbol of freedom and communion. Film directors got interest in the phenomenon and contributed to its popularity. By the end of the 1990s, the resonance and the power of attraction of the repertoire had spread all over Italy. The Salento had become an exotic place to be visited to enjoy authentic experiences through the powerful music of ancient ritual. These are the of some films. The Chapel of St. Paul of Galatina had been included in a tour of Tarantist tourism, who wanted to see the places where Tarantata gather on the 29th of June, asking for the grace of the saints. And Taranta rituals were performed, as you can see in these pictures. In the process of the rediscovery, the folk traditions, also the municipalities started being reappreciated and even restored. Seasonal fairs were organized where traditional food was sold during folk music concerts. Other forms of music, such as hip-hop, reggae, and techno, were circulating along with new pizzica. From this intertwining and mixing together, from this magmatic world, which joined tradition and innovation, emerged various groups. One of the most significant among them is Mascheri Miri, the group founded by Claudio Cavallo Gianniotti, still working on new projects which synthesize in original compositions the sound of folk tradition with electronic music. Here is a sample. I would like you to listen. In the time span of about a decade, the folk revival had become a fruitful business for many groups who could perform on the stages of festivals, municipality fairs, marriages, celebrations, and private gatherings. It was also a good business for politicians who could gain political consent by sponsoring concerts of folk music. Indeed, many groups and musicians of folk music were soon co-opted and controlled by politicians. The strength and consistency of their action was such that by the beginning of 2000s, the public funds were almost exclusively distributed to groups of folk music and dance. Other musical genres, such as jazz music or blues, received minimum patronage, and for this reason, several musicians turned to folk music. Furthermore, being the main sponsors and favoring these groups, which were more collaborative instead of those who produced good music, politicians legitimated part-time musicians and disqualified professional musicians. Two important and connected events which impressed a new direction to the second folk revival were the creation of the Institute Diego Carpitella, a center for the study of the local tradition, and the organization of the festival La Notte della Taranta. The Istituto Diego Carpitella was founded by Sergio Blasi, major of the municipality of Melpignano, Luigi Chigliatti, musician and researcher protagonist of both the first and the second revival, the anthropologist Eugenio Embriani, and musicologist Maurizio Magamennone and Gianfranco Salvatore. The Institute was supported also by a consortium of five municipalities, which soon increased, including the Union of the Municipalities of Salentinian Greece. The statute of the festival, La Notte della Taranta, clearly stated that the most significant aspect of the plan is the intention to organize an important original event to be directed by an authoritative Italian or foreigner musician and composer whose presence might facilitate further diffusion of the interest around Tarantism and folk music. The first edition of the festival under the direction of Daniele Sepe, a musician with experiences in folk music, jazz and experimental music, received appreciation, but also generated contrasts and debates. The idea to contaminate folk tradition with contemporary musical genres such as jazz, rock and world music was not appreciated by all. The issue of contamination of traditional music became hot and ignited the debate, making of it an argument of public discussion involving performers, intellectuals, anthropologists, and people in general. It was within this cultural climate that Ghettonia, a group which over the years had already widened its sound and expanded its repertoire with the inclusion of the Albanian accordionist and composer Admir Skurtaj, completed a further step towards a new sound, including the jazz musician Antonio Cotardo. At this point, they had all the elements to produce a balanced and effective synthesis of folk music and Salento, of Salento with jazz. After two more quite successful editions, due to contrasting positions, on the organization of the festival, Agamennone and Salvatore resigned. Thus, the Institute Diego Carpitella came entirely under the general direction of the Major Sergio Blasi, supported by the Union of the Municipalities of Salentinian Greece and by Sergio Torsello as Artistic Director of the festival. From that moment onward, the main aim of the direction was to use the festival as a tourist attraction, and all the efforts were directed towards giving it international visibility. In 2003, Stuart Copeland, former of drummer of the internationally acclaimed group The Police, was invited as a musical director. Tens of thousands of people attended the final concert, which was also broadcasted on national television. The marketing operation was successful, and Salento became extremely popular both as a model for cultural business and as a touristic attraction. In 2005, Niki Vendola, leader of the Left Party, was elected as president of the region Puglia. He embraced the project of the festival and guaranteed it strong economical support, providing in this way political recognition of its success as a model for tourist development and as a safeguard of local culture and identity. From then onwards, the concert of the festival, the final concert, followed the typical format: a well-known musician engaged in music as music director, a small bunch of traditional pieces performed every year with a novel musical arrangement by the orchestra of La Notte della Taranta, and special guest musicians. Interestingly, the space given to the dance increased significantly over the years, and the simple dances based on few traditional steps becomes extended choreography, which did not maintain any connection with the tradition. In the span of a few years, the concert evolved into a typical television show, as it clearly visible from these pictures. Taking change as a natural process of any tradition, I intend now to observe how social changes have contributed to the shaping and evolution of the folk tradition of Salento and point out some interesting aspects hidden beyond the surface. The starting point of the narration is the tradition as it was observed by De Martino at the end of the 1950s. It was not a tradition in full vigor since its own world, which had survived to the Second World War, was undergoing a change. Music was an integral part of the life of people and accompanied specific moments of their lives. Musical heritage was not held by a specialized group of composition, and compositions were connected to specific moments of the religious or agricultural calendar. Musicians were not professionals, and anybody could learn to play an instrument. Now, if we look to the first folk revival, we see that the protagonists were not members of agricultural community. The songs did not follow traditional modalities. They used to perform concerts on the stage and they did not play according to the schedule of ritual time and space as regulated by the tradition. They proposed the revised version of the traditional songs and texts. Moreover, they were external agents who intended to recover and dignify a culture that mostly was in their mind. On the other side, society had significantly changed from the end of the 1950s, and the members of the community which was targeted by the revivalists as equally significant changed. They were no more ready to think to the old life of their ancestors. Moreover, they were neither interested in their own culture or in the version of that culture that was proposed by the folk revivalist. Due to these reasons, the first revival could not work in its aims, and in fact, it did not. The second stream of revival shows again a different situation. Although the process of revival was mostly activated by young students, within a very short span of time, it spread involving, as performing an audience, people of different age and social background. In this case, the discovery of their musical tradition was motivated by the search of identity and roots. Moreover, it soon became manifest that it was not a search of content, of culture, or a vision of the world, but an aesthetic adhesion. The contemporary tradition that comes out from the Second Revival, in fact, is an invention based on few musical elements of a section of the ritual repertoire, the music played in the ritual of Tarantism, which is no more embodied. In fact, Taranta spiders and Tarantate are extinguished, and the same agricultural community which represented and maintained the tradition to which they belonged is almost extinct. Interestingly, the new tradition is a collective invention. Musicians, the revivalists, and the few living representatives of the tradition, audience and politicians, all together collaborated to the creation of a world of fiction, a fake world which gives easy relief and incomes to those who participate and makes them feel like taking part to a collective ritual of trance in which everybody becomes a happy tarantato. It is a fiction of the recreation of a mythic time of collective participation and sharing, the fiction of reviving of a tradition by making business of it, by selling it to others who wish to participate to a dream which culminates in the ritual of the festival La Notte della Taranta. The issue of identity, both at individual and community level, has been at the core of the second folk revival and folk music. We have seen it. Tamburello and Tarantism have been used as identity makers. However, if we consider how music and musical instruments evolved in this process, we see that their identities have been lost. I will take as an example the tamburello. It has been said that due to its role in the healing ritual of Tarantism, the tamburello soon became the emblem of folk revival. In Italy, tamburello is a name attributed to any drum with jingle fixed in the with single skin fixed on a circular frame in which jingling metallic discs are inserted. The word tamburello indicates the hand-bass drum used in classical music orchestra and sold in any musical instrument shop, as well as the folk frame drum, which has similar features but is a different instrument and has a different voice. As soon as the frenzy to play the tamburello spread among people, the need came to find an instrument. At the beginning of the 1990s, Mesciunino of Nocilia was the only traditional tamburello maker in Salento. While at the very beginning people started buying brass bass drums, someone soon understood that the making of tamburello might have been a good business and set up workshops. Within a few years, they built a business, a real business, selling tamburellos branded with their own signature during festivals, fairs, and any occasion in which folk music was played. Soon tamburello makers started creating a variety of tamburellos by adopting different animal skins, kinds of wood and metals for the jingling discs, and eventually creating specific designs on the wooden frame as well on the skin. In this process, the traditional tamburello, with its rustic aspect and powerful sound, was lost. It was not replaced by a new typical model, but by a multitude of tamburellos. While we could point out a number of positive aspects resulting from the new interest in the drum making, it is quite clear that the traditional tamburello that had been played until the 1980s had almost disappeared. A question might be addressed now, has to be addressed, according to me. If tamburello for the last 20 years has not been a single and clearly distinguishable instrument, but a multiplicity of drums sharing just few superficial elements, how can it still be emblematic of cultural identity? And connected to this, another question comes. If we really take it as an emblem of a culture, then should it be a culture devoid of a precise identity? Pizzica, intended as the rhythm played during the ritual performed to hear the tarantate, has gone through a process very similar to tamburello, and the entire repertoire has been strongly influenced by pop music, losing most of its main features. However, in the clashing of the vanishing world of traditional music of Salento with the contemporary world and its pop noisy formats, very few voices have been able to sensitively adjust the sound of the tradition to present time. Among them deserves to be mentioned Enza Pagliara and Dario Mucci for their individual project and for the project they carry with their own label. I like to conclude by listening to this piece. Okay, I have to stop. At this point, I thank again everybody, and I hope it was clear, my lecture, even my pronunciation. Thank you again.
Professor Paolo Pacciola presented a wonderful paper, with illustrations, making it very meaningful and experiential for all of us. I have few observations to make that I want to dwell upon. Number one, that we observed that their tradition was primarily a vocal based, but later dance got prominence into it. And number two, that role of municipalities has really impacted in surviving the ethnic culture very strongly. And I feel it is a very rare thing that where any municipalities is encouraging the local artist to come forward and again revive that culture. So it has been a wonderful, I would say, gesture on the municipality side to encourage and revive and survive their tradition. Number three, impact of globalization has been there, and that took place. And we saw in the initial clippings that their tradition was very much different, which was more like that we say that what they were performing initially, but later with the impact of globalization, you could see that they are adding different steps, different kind of a music to it, and different presentation. So impact of globalization was very much vital in that. We could vividly see that. Then the role of artists have been very vital in popularizing these ethnic forms. And people were really fascinated the way they started getting impacted with e-sources, with kind of a costumes, with kind of a presentation, so that people, common people interest from jazz and pop had shifted to their kind of a music, ethnic music, when they also got the platform on televisions and the concert halls. Timbirella has become very popular and many people started manufacturing it, thus giving a livelihood to many people around. And this is very close to our Duff and I would say Kanjira of South, which has primarily the purpose of giving rhythm. So I think so we can also have some kind of a study about it. Then Pitsika became very popular and has variety of rhythmic patterns. And during this performance, I also observed that there are a lot of oscillations. And I would say when they were singing, the artist was singing, I could also recollect my memory about when the artist of Rajasthan and Punjab and Carnatic music use these oscillations in their voice. And plus their dance movements also reminded me of our Seven Sisters dance movements at certain places. I'm now thinking that in future, if any researcher from any one country would be interested to do a comparative study of such rituals and such ethnic forms to our counterpart of Indian ethnic forms of our societies, that would be a wonderful research and a common platform to gain knowledge. We have many kind of researches done in our department where other institutions have come forward, their scholars have come forward and done the studies in comparative studies of instruments and musical forms from Asia and Africa and America. But I think so, if we can look forward and encourage someone to do this, that this seminar will really become then meaningful. Thank you so much, Professor Paola Picciola, for giving such a wonderful paper presentation. And thank you, the entire team, for making it possible. Thanks very much. Namaskar.
With that, we conclude the first webinar of the first day, and now straight away moving on to the second webinar. The topic is traditional music in South Asia, Sri Lanka. And chairing this session is Professor Kanna Kumar. Panelist is Dr. Ravi Bandhu Vidyapathi. Let me introduce the chairperson, Professor Kanna Kumar, to all of you. He joined the Music Department, University of Delhi, as a teaching faculty in the year 1993 and is presently serving as professor in the same department. His prodigious musical talents were recognized and nurtured by his initial guru, Ustad Sayyid Pasha Sahab. He did his MPhil and PhD from the Department of Music, University of Delhi. Sir had advanced training in Carnatic music, vocal, from Maha Mahopadhyay Vidwan, Sri T.R. Subramanyam and Professor Radha Venkatachalam. He was fortunate to learn rare and popular kritis of Carnatic music under several eminent veterans and maestros of Carnatic music. Professor Kanna Kumar is a graded artist of All India Radio, Prasar Bharati and Doordarshan Delhi. He has to his credit a number of articles on music published in various music magazines and has authored a book as well. Professor Kanna Kumar has received many awards and titles from prestigious institutions of the country. The panel consists of Sri Ravi Bandhu Vidyapathi, traditional dancer, choreographer, percussionist, and composer from Sri Lanka. He studied traditional Kandyan dancing and drumming at Chitrasena School of Dance for 10 years. He took tutelage of Kathakali at Kerala Kalamandalam. Sri Ravi Bandhu studied North Indian classical vocal and tabla and pakhavaj. He also took training in acting and theatre direction and further studied painting and design arts also. Sri Vidyapathi is the former chairman of National Dance and Ballet Advisory Panel, Arts Council of Sri Lanka. Among the numerous awards and honours bestowed upon him, the notable ones are Kala Kirti, the Presidential Award of Sri Lanka, Dirana Sri Lanka of the Year Award, Nritya Bhimani State Award, Banka Award from Embassy of Japan and Japan Sri Lanka Friendship Association. The drum symphonies created by him and composed by him have been presented on prestigious platforms and hugely appreciated. He has presented papers in international and local symposium. I now request Professor Kanna Kumar to begin the session.
Namaskar to everybody. I welcome Sri Ravi Bandhu Vidyapathi from Sri Lanka to the webinar on traditional music in different cultures, challenges and opportunities in the changing global scenario. Today, in this second session, Sri Vidyapathi will speak on meter and melody and overview of the Sinhala traditional music of Sri Lanka. Through this session, we will all come to know about the Sinhala traditional music practiced in Sri Lanka. We would also hear about the role of drums in Sinhala traditional music. The speaker will throw light on Buddhist religious music, traditional dance and ritual music and folk music. His focus will be on importance of drums, ensembles such as Panchaturya Nada in various ceremonies. Further, he will deliberate on traditional dance music of the Sinhalese with reference to drums. He will touch upon their styles, techniques, along with chants and songs. And also he will enlighten us with the development of Sri Lankan music as a modern art. Now I request Sri Ravi Bandhu Vidyapathi to speak on the topic.
Ayubovan. Meter and Melody, an overview of the traditional and folk music of the Sinhala people of Sri Lanka. The aim of this paper is to give a general overview of the traditional and folk music of the Sinhalese community of Sri Lanka, whose religious faith is predominantly Buddhist. I wish to start with a quote on folk music by the British folklorist Cecil James Sharp. quote, "Folk music is the product of a race and reflects feelings and tastes that are communal rather than personal. Its creation is never completed, while at every moment of history it exists not in one form but in many." Unquote. Folk dance and folk music are the spontaneous outburst of the primary human feelings and emotions. While folk dance expressed the joyous moments of human life, the folk music subtly penetrated to touch various aspects of human feelings such as happiness, sorrow, sympathy, empathy, hope, anger, serenity, and even protest ideas. Inspired by nature as it evolved, folk music enjoys an immense freedom of expression. According to C.J. Sharp, I quote again, "Folk music is natural music. In its making, it is not controlled by conscious applications of conventional rules and restrictions." Unquote. Thus, it is not framed by rigid technical restrictions or formalities, but moves within loosely demarcated stylistic indications as interpreted by individuals or groups of people from generation to generation. Civilizations, cultures, the arts and traditions within those cultures, and the forms, styles, and techniques in those arts are entities that are constantly evolving, and evolve they must if they are to survive. That is the law of nature, and the process of evolution is always one of give and take, assimilation and integration. We know that neighboring countries have many similar cultural expressions. The last geographical separation of earth plates have taken place some 7,500 years ago. We were geographically separated, but our cultural roots were not. Therefore, Sri Lanka shares many cultural similarities with those of South India. Here is an example. This tune of the folk dance song Kumiyadi of South India resembles the Sri Lankan Kandyan dance tunes of Turanga Vannama and Ukusa Vannama based on the same scale of notes. Now listen to this Sri Lankan traditional dance song from the Kandyan style, the Turanga Vannama, which is almost in the same melodic structure but in a different time cycle. The dancer or the singer takes the pitch from the drum. Traditional Sinhala music can be traced in our ancient dance ritual chants and folk songs. Major part of the rituals consists of complex drum rhythms and chants that are associated with the dance. Besides, we also had a classical court music tradition that came down with the Indian princesses who were married to our kings in as far back as the Anuradhapura period. Later, in the 17th century, stronger South Indian ties were made when the Nayakar kings took over the rule of the Kandyan kingdom. Thus, a natural integration of what filtered down from South India and our own indigenous music have paved the way for our mainstream traditional music of today. Folk and traditional music of Sri Lanka can be divided into three main categories. They are, number one, Buddhist religious music, two, ritual and dance music, three, folk music. Buddhist music. There are two distinct branches of Buddhist music. Number one, the spiritual chanting of the sacred scriptures by the monks in pirit ceremonies. The singular word pirit connotes blessing or benediction, and musically, this chanting does not exceed three notes in its renditions. Professor Ratan Jankar had this to say about pirit chanting. I quote, "They struck me as the equivalent prototypes of the Vedic incantations," unquote.
Iti piso bhagava arham samma.
The second type of Buddhist music is the ceremonial music of the Buddhist temples performed by laymen that exhibits serene yet high musicality and also technical virtuosity. Music belongs to the elaborate dance rituals and consists of vast repertories of songs and chants and long and complex phrases of drumming that accompany the dance. Rituals are night-long elaborate dance ceremonies that are performed to cure sick persons or their households of any maledictions. These all-encompassing psychotherapeutic performances contain well-codified varieties of dance, some characterization and dramatic enactments, and also skillful drumming by large ensembles. Folk music. The large variety of folk songs that constitute our folk music can be divided into a few categories and are associated with the day-to-day life of the people. Some of the types of folk songs are, number one, Keligi, songs associated with different types of folk games and sports. Likeligi, songs that accompany the playing of sticks. Ek Valapungi lamentation songs. These lamentation songs were sung at funeral houses in the past, but today very rarely in practice. Bale Pembara Ganiti Vanna associated with different kinds of professions. Goyang Ghi, songs of the paddy field workers. Rituals. Song from the Deval Madhu ritual that accompanies the dance. Palamua Bodonga Mandala. Traditional orchestra of Sri Lanka. Drums played an important role in constituting the traditional music of Sri Lanka. The traditional music ensemble associated mainly with Buddhist street pageants and temple ceremonies is called the Pancha Thurya Nada, the collective sound of five types of instruments. And drums comprise 3/5 of this categorization as follows. Atata, drums played with hands. Vitata, drums played with sticks. Atata vitata, drums that use hand and sticks. Ghana, metal instruments. Sushira, wind instruments. This classification with slight variations is found in a 6th century text, the Vansathappakasini, a commentary on the Mahavansa, the great chronicle of Sri Lanka, and can be understood as specific to Sri Lanka. It is interesting to note that similar concepts and terms are found in neighboring cultures too. Panchavadyam of Kerala and Panchabaji of Nepal are noteworthy instances. The art of drumming in Sri Lanka developed in two main directions over the centuries. Robust and dynamic as accompaniment to dance on the one hand, and tranquil and serene as temple drumming on the other hand. The entire gamut of our rhythms emanate from four rudimental sounds: tat, jit, tom, na. Tat, jit, tom, na. They in turn produce other basic rhythms that develop into hundreds of complex rhythmic phrases and compositions. Earlier are common to some of the South Indian drums too, such as mridangam, ghadam, ganjira and tabla. Drumming as a modern performing art. The cultural renaissance in Sri Lanka under the inspirited stimulus of the Bengali Renaissance and the arrival of Rabindranath Tagore in 1934 in Sri Lanka saw a gradual transformation of the traditional performing arts. From the ritual arena to the proscenium stage was a big leap that was taken by the performing arts. Tagore's Sak Mochan created a sensation among Sri Lankan artists and connoisseurs. Along with the dance, drumming and singing to cater to the needs of the modern stage, new forms of drumming and singing emerged. Folk music became a base for creative music. The change of its performing space from open arena to the focused stage resulted in the expressing of subtler nuances of drumming and traditional singing. The new drumming art thrived through the 1960s. traditional drums became an indispensable component in theatre music and in the music scores for Sri Lankan dance dramas. By the mid-1960s, it had crept into the radio song, which so far featured the North Indian tabla as its rolling rhythm companion. In the mid-20th century, Sri Lankan musicians were largely attracted towards North Indian classical music. Those who had their music education at institutes like Shantiniketan and Bhatkande were instrumental in introducing Hindustani music to the school curricula and other arts institutes. Thus, it has become the main classical music of Sri Lanka today. Western classical music, which was confined to a certain social strata, is also becoming more popular, mainly due to its usage in modern applied music. The baila and kafrinya, the styles of singing that the Portuguese left us, remains yet another line of popular music. Besides, a thin line of jazz music also exists side by side. Sri Lanka was exposed to the open economy in the late 1970s. Television was introduced in 1982. Lately, the impact of social media was felt adversely. These three determinatives have lured many healthy and unhealthy formations in the performing arts. By the 1990s, drummers started combining with different genres of music: Western classical, Indian classical, jazz, pop, and rock. Compositions were written for traditional drums and symphony orchestras. Here is an example, a composition that I wrote for the Candian Drums and Orchestra. Versus modernity. The impact of globalization is adversely felt in many fields of traditional arts, so music simply cannot escape. The easy exposure to the numerous cross-cultural exercises that happen around the world today attracts young amateurs to fearlessly fuse traditions and styles. Such attempts result in both healthy and unhealthy formations. Healthy, perhaps they provide opportunities to explore into new areas of sound and rhythm. Unhealthy because of a possible adulteration of traditions caused by mediocre artists. Music in a pandemic time. The pandemic has ruthlessly affected the performing arts. We know that the performer and the spectator must come together physically and indulge in an intellectual and emotional dialogue for a successful performance to occur. Today, the pandemic has deprived us of these beautiful meeting opportunities. It has attacked the music field practically in two ways. One, the flow of the art of music as a socio-cultural activity has been subdued. Two, it has seriously affected the survival of the musicians. Well, in some countries, the music unions took measures to help the artists, orchestras, music groups, and performers to pay their salaries and provided other facilities like finding alternative performing opportunities. On the other hand, artists too stepped down to support the survival of the music art and the performers through virtual performances. But the artists of Sri Lanka did not catch up on that yet. If at all they did, it is only the pop music groups. The Sri Lankan public seems to be yet unaccustomed to pay and watch performances online. Even the government authorities are reluctant to consider music and dance as professions. Perhaps they think that musicians are mere entertainers and not a part of the country's development, both material and spiritual.
Sir, very impressive lecture. We all thoroughly enjoyed and came to know about the traditional music prevalent in Sri Lanka. You have very nicely brought about the importance of drums in Sinhala traditional music. Thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us. The speech was very informative. All of us have gained knowledge about Sinhala music. I am a Carnatic musician and it has been a great pleasure to know about the traditional art forms existing in Sri Lanka. I hope the lecture has given further scope to students to make a comparison with Indian music. All vocalists and instrumentalists are very much aware of the role of drums and other instruments in enhancing meter and melody in musical concerts. Drums give beauty not only to melody, but also to any kind of tala. And Sri Ravibandhu Vidyapati brought out the importance of drums very nicely, be it in religious music such as Buddhist chants, folk music, or traditional dance. Traditional music will flourish with all the above aspects. He also threw light on the new development of Sri Lankan music as a modern art with special focus on drums. It was also interesting to know about the ensemble Panchaturya Nada, which has similarity to the Panchavadya of Kerala. The pandemic COVID-19 confined all of us to our homes, and the performing artists faced many hardships during that time. However, we all learned to come out of it by the use of technology and its benefits. Once again, I thank Sri Ravibandhu Vidyapati to have given us his valuable time to be a part of this international webinar. Namaskar.
After the webinars, we now begin our concert series. We now present Karnatak Veena Recital by Dr. S.V. Shahana from Mysore. Dr. S.V. Shahana is one of the acclaimed Veena artists of the country, being the disciple of M.G. Srinivas Iyengar, a very senior and distinguished Veena exponent. She flowered into a concert artist at the age of 14. Shahana is also one among the select disciples of the Veena and vocal virtuoso Sri T.N. Seshagopalan, Padma Bhushan awardee. Presently, she is taking her advanced training under Dr. T.V. Gopalakrishnan, Padma Bhushan awardee. On the academic front, Shahana is a master's degree holder in Veena, Carnatic Music from University of Madras. She is a recipient of a junior and senior research fellowship from UGC. Shahana has been awarded the doctorate in music from University of Mysore for her thesis, Impact on Advanced Technology on Carnatic Instrumental Music, a Study. She is an A-grade artist of All India Radio and Doordarshan. Dr. S.V. Shahana has performed extensively at prestigious national and international festivals. Today, accompanying her on Mridangam is Vidwan Radhesh A. Karnatak Veena Recital by Dr. S.V. Shahana.
Namaste. I am Dr. Shahana S.V. from Mysore. I'm very happy to present a Veena recital for the international webinar organized by Music Department of University of Delhi. For today's concert, I'll be accompanied on the Mridangam by Mysore A. Radhesh. We will commence our concert with a composition in the raga Charukeshi, Aada Modi Galade. It's a composition of Sri Tyagaraja set to Aditalam.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
After that beautiful Karnatak Veena recital, we now present Western music recital by Dr. Vararat Varirik and group from Thailand. After graduating in dramatic arts, Dr. Vararat did her master's in ethnomusicology from Bangkok. She's a child prodigy, in fact, who started winning awards and accolades from the age of 8 years. Dr. Vararat has composed music for films and television in Thailand, has acted in musical theatres, sung for music bands, taught dramatic arts and music in different universities of Thailand. She is the Deputy Dean in Academic Session in Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences at Pibul Songkram Rajabhat University, Pit Sanulong. Today, she and her band present Western music recital. The band is called The Busy Man Project by Music PSRU. And today they are presenting jazz and fusion. So let's begin this recital.
Hello, Namaskar Ji. I am Dr. Vararat Varirak. First of all, I would like to say thank you, and I feel really thankful to Professor Deepti Omchery, Bhalla, Dean and Head of Music Department, University of Delhi, as she invited all of us to perform our band today in a prestigious webinar this year. Thank you very much to ma'am. As our band name is The Busy Man Project by PSRU, and we will perform in fusion jazz style. But the first song that we would like to present to all of you, titled as Don't It Make My Brown Eyes Blue. Please enjoy.
So blue, Bye.
So right now, I would like to say thank you very much for watching our music performance. Before saying goodbye to everyone, I would like to introduce our artists one by one to you. First, Assistant Professor Dr. Kamontham Gerbut on guitar. He is our head of music department of PSRU University as well. The next one, Sergeant Parkin McLoy on saxophone. And another side of mine, lecturer Mr. Ekapon Yatuam on bass. At the back side, lecturer Mr. Wallop Ngam Koklang on keyboard. And the middle of the stage, lecturer Mr. Nopadon Panpet on drum. Of course, the last one is me, vocalist Dr. Wararat Warirak. Right now, time's up. So we all would like to say thank you very much. But in Hindi word, Bahut Dhanyawad Namaskar Ji.
With that, we conclude the first day's program of the two-day international webinar, Traditional Music in Different Cultures, Opportunities and Challenges in the Changing Global Scenario. On behalf of Department of Music, University of Delhi, we take your leave for today and hoping to meet you tomorrow again on the second day of our international webinar. Thank you. Namaste.